Basically, again, yes, because it's kind of based on that.
Do you have time to tell it one more time? Because it was the difficult.
What was the difficult?
The whole.
The whole story. Okay. Again, kind of cilia, sitting here, okay? And embedded, I didn't mention this, stereo cilia, how many stereo cilia do we have of a monster?
100.
Approximately 100, okay? Can be 50 to 150, that's why I say 100. Okay? And the stereo cilia are embedded in this gelous, I didn't mention, gel-like substance, the nanometer capsule membrane. Now, so the stereo cilia is in the endolymph, because endolymph comes from this way. Having intracellular iron content, so less sodium, natrium, and more potassium or calcium, kind of. Okay. Then, under this barrier, which is made by the supporting cells or the pharyngeal cells from the wall, if they process this, under this, we have different compartments. No, it doesn't have an interesting name, but it's kind of limiting membrane, otherwise, so that is the role. And the space here, which surrounds the cell bodies of the receptor cells and also the pharyngeal cells, called the space of Muel. Muel. M-U-E-L.
N-O?
N-U.
N-U.
Not Noel?
Yep.
Muel. In French? Okay. Muel. Okay, with you. And this space and this fluid here comes from this trigone, from the cortic tunnel, the fluid of which is called cortic lymph, and this receives it from the lower lymphatic space, which is the lympha, and this has extracellular, like, you know, iron content. It means more sodium, so natrium, and less potassium or calcium. Okay, that will be important for the deposition. One more thing: tectorial membrane has closer contact with the outer absence, as you can see here, compared to the inner. Okay, so these cells will be in contact first with the tectorial membrane if we elevate the lateral membrane from below, because this will be the thing of the depolarization. Okay, when the traveling wave travels here in the lower, it elevates the basal membrane, and that's why the stereo cilia of the outer hair cells will be bounded by the tectorial membrane. Good, but let's go back to the airways. Okay, what happens? Airways vibrate the tympanic membrane. You have to do this even if you get this question. The tympanic membrane, and because you know we have two ossicles, especially one in close contact with the tympanic membrane, that is the malleus, this movement is transmitted to the malleus. But if you remember, the malleus moves together with the incus around the common axis, you have to know. And that's why both will swing, invert, and push, you know, the stapes at the end in the oval window to the paralymphatic space. So this is how the ossicles, and you can measure that here quite important, 22 times amplification by the ossicles. So the airways are amplified to the paralymphatic space by the ossicles, that's why we need ossicles. And then the states can create in the upper paralymphatic space, which means this. Okay, you see the scalar residue. That's why I mentioned again, the traveling wave first ascends the 2.5 turns to the tip of the cochlea, okay, cupula, and because we have a helical tremor, so communication between the upper and lower, then the traveling wave comes down in the lower paralymphatic space, which would be here, the scalar tympanum. And when it travels in the lower, it elevates the vascular membrane. And according to the width of the vascular membrane, what I showed you in the first photo, we have a frequency-dependent, you know, most sensitive part of the vascular membrane. Otherwise, everywhere is elevated, of course, by the ferroid blade. The low frequency sounds are perceived mostly at the highest point and vice versa. Okay. Good. Now, when the traveling wave going here elevates the vascular membrane. The sterile cilia will be bended by the tractory membrane.
Will be?
Bended. Okay. So, good. And what happens? These are special mechanosensors. We have a special protein in the cell membrane of the outer receptor cells called prestin. And when it senses the pressure, I mean, from this tilting, it changes its conformation. And this way, there's a signal to the cytoskeleton to change also, and the cell will shorten. Have you heard about it? The cell will shorten immediately when the pressure is on the sterile cilia. And that arises. Then we have immediately elongation of the cell with the relaxation of the cytoskeleton and hyperolysis. And again, shortening, elongation, that's a series of this. And it means with the movement of the outer hair cells, shortening and elongations, can vibrate even more the tractory membrane. And that's why it transmits the signal with amplification to the inner hair cell. Okay, so the outer hair cell just for the amplification of the dynamic stimulus, vibrating more the or vibrating the tractory membrane, and this way the inner hair cell can detect this in this cell. But the inner hair cell will be the most crucial for the tonotopic localization of the perception. This will be then the most important for the tonotopic or sonotopic localization of the sound perception. And this is what I said, on the highest point of the vascular membrane, we can detect the frequency sounds, and at the bottom, so closer to the round window, we have the high frequency perception. And of course, between that, we have the others. As I told you, traveling wave is created everywhere, but each frequency has the highest amplitude somewhere regarding the elevation. This will be the most specific for the sound. Okay, this is the beginning of this. Plus, here we see the peripheral processes of the vascular cells, you know, which run around to the receptors to get the info. And what is interesting, 90% of the cochlear fibers are related to the inner hair cell. However, only one row. Okay? And it means almost nothing runs to the outer hair cells. It's true, and it's logic because that is not for the sonotopic localization, and nobody knows the role of the rest of 3% of the fibers which run to the outer hair cells because we don't detect the sound from there. Maybe this is a correction, I just added to this. I haven't read it, but we have a the superiority levels yesterday. I mentioned the pathway, if you remember. So this was on Wednesday especially. But this was tougher. That was the third order neuron of the whole cochlear pathway versus the bicorners and second is the probably cochlear nucleus. And the third is the superiority nucleus and the inferior colliculus and the eugenically, but this is the pathway. But otherwise, from the superiority nucleus, if we have too much excitation, you know, incoming signals, the superiority nucleus send interference to these receptors to block the transmission. Okay, so in the ear, we have several defenses for or against the overstimulation, started already with the tensor tympani muscle and stapedius muscles, okay? And we have a neural blockade as well, using this pathway called olivocochlear tract, coming from the superior nucleus to the receptors, okay? Something similar to the Golgi cell in the cerebellum, if you remember, if you have too much excitation to muscle fibers, Golgi can block the transmission between the muscle fiber and the dendrite of the brain cell, okay?